Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Late Night Radio with Freeman Jack. We'll be taking you into the late hours. Way, way into the late hours. And bending your mind.
You have meddled with the primal forces of nature, Mr. Beale, and I...
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Freeman Jack with the Open Omniversity. This is our first broadcast on People's Internet Radio. First of all, I'd like to give the listeners a sort of potted introduction to what is an omniversity. In order to introduce the concept of the omniversity, first of all, the terminology. The reason why I chose omniversity was as a diametric opposite to university. Effectively, a university is somewhere where you often go that's away from home, away from your friends and family. You're taken out of your home environment. You are essentially made to conform to a very strict set of absorbing and then regurgitating of a very strict set of single data. You may be inclined to pursue some courses of research during your education, but largely the education that you'll receive at university will be on a single subject, and it will be on the agreed part of that single subject alone. Now, firstly, because of the digital revolution, the age of the university has essentially passed. By the time any university degree course can make it to the paperwork that feeds into that degree course, which the students will rely on, it is at least 5 years out of date. That is the lead time that it takes for the work to be accepted, for it to be induced into the university curriculum, and for that induction to then be produced into something that can be seen as a semblance of an exam grade subject material. So essentially every subject being taught at university, by the time it's being taught, is at least 5 years old. And in the modern age, as you're about to hear during the course of this show, 5 years is too old. Now, that's not to say that science is entirely without its merits. And moreover, you'll have just spent the last 2 hours listening to the fabulous Lee, Unique Lee, on his dark side of the room. And in enough respect for his researches and for the fabulous work that he does, exposing the matters that he exposes. However, broadly, the mediums that he is going to for the source of that information are propagandized. They are the mainstream medias, and even if they are reporting on mainstream science, that mainstream science is, broadly speaking, propagandized. The version of mainstream science that we receive through the mainstream media is incredibly heavily filtered. To a degree, I can make this point in absolute clarity for you. How many programs are there on television that you can think of currently that cover any aspect of computer science? I was thinking about this earlier, and apart from an occasional Horizon on the BBC, and an occasional, perhaps, special on BBC Four, the only programmes that routinely cover computer science are the silly little 15-minute short on the news channel of Click Online, and the Channel 5 gadget show. And even that covers nothing of computer science. It's largely just, buy this, it's good. So, the concept of omniversity was one of the diametric opposite of the university. I began to realise that the reason why I was arriving at the, for my mind, more reasonable and rational conclusions than those presented through mainstream medias of the sciences was simply that I had had such a diverse group of interests, and due to my diligence had managed to pursue them to some satisfaction and some conclusion. And so the omniversity, in its very conception, is that it is the open door. It is the university that comes to your home. It's not a university, though. It's an omniversity. We're not aiming to teach you a single subject. We're aiming to teach you about every subject. So in the next few weeks, I hope to be covering on a very broad base of issues I will do my very best to present each one of those issues from its very most basic concepts going through as the program progresses through to some sort of a conclusion about the state of that subject, the state of the current science on that subject, and how it's likely to move forward moving into the future. So in order to accomplish that, I think first of all we need to discuss the actual topic that is under discussion today, which is the topic of computer science. Let me just pull up the Word document here. The actual subject title is the Googleplex, is the universe's first synthetic mind. And in the show blog, the hardware and software that makes up everything Google and all other internet search engines, but I'm primarily focusing on Google, is now the universe's first synthetic mind, with the Googleplex hard and soft structures being the neural network and each Google user its synapse. The first truly transhuman structure, and it is entirely passive and purely collaborative, not coercive. Okay, here's Tim Berners-Lee, basically giving an outline of, first of all to point out that Tim Berners-Lee is essentially the man who invented the internet almost single-handedly. He's also the man who I'm going to present fairly strong evidence for this evening, who essentially allowed the internet into the wild. He was working surreptitiously within structures like DARPANET, the military network systems, and CERN, as was mentioned earlier. And I'm going to let Tim speak for himself. This is the wonderful Tim Berners-Lee.
Thanks, Bob. So people say sometimes, OK, so you invented the web. So are you some genius or something, or are you just in the right place at the right time? And I'm going to spend a few minutes making the case that I was in the right place at the right time. And in fact, kind of wistfully, my feeling is that I and the few people of this generation our particular path that we took through learning about technology and implementing technology maybe was a one-off. Maybe that's it. If you're younger, and quite a lot of you are, a depressing number of you are, then maybe you've had it. I'm sorry. Maybe you've missed it. You know, and maybe you'll feel about us like I felt about just missing Woodstock and the Isle of Wight Festival. You know, just being a little too young to really get it, that I should have hoofed it over there to one of those two places and been there when it all happened, just by a few years, a few months. So my path, I suppose I started off what I'm going to talk to you about. So I'm going to go back to when I was in utero. My mum and dad had met, when they were both working in Manchester on the Franti Mark I computer. Franti Mark I computer came out of Manchester University, and the Mark I computer was very exciting because there were a few people who realised that the programmable computer, as Alan Turing actually proved mathematically, the programmable computer was something different from anything else that's ever been before. Because any programmable computer could be programmed to emulate any other one. So they could all do the same set of things. If you could program this computer to do something, you could program that other computer to do exactly the same thing. It may do it more slowly, it might run out of memory. In fact, they tend to talk about infinite computers. But there's this idea that comes out of that, that a computer can do whatever you can imagine. So as a programmer, this thing, it's not, painting is great. It's a lot of fun, and you get to express yourself with a palette knife and thing, and singing is fun, and you get to express yourself. But when you write a program, then you really, imagine that your output is the screen. Anything you can imagine, any form of interaction, any form of calculation, anything that you can imagine this thing doing, it's up to your imagination to program it. You ought to be able to program it if you can imagine what it's doing. That's throwing down a huge gauntlet to the creativity of people. So that when I grew up, my parents bought a house in London that they're still in, and in that house, they're both basically mathematicians, and so that house was full of how exciting it was, also full of five-hole paper tape. Five-hole paper tape is good for lots of things. It's good for feeding information into a computer, like in some of the old sci-fi movies. And it's also really good for throwing across the room. It's good, if I had to have a pile of it here, I would throw it from the stage, which is what we used to do in our the pantomimes we put on the dining room table. So the world was full of computing, the excitement of it, and also and of mathematics and the fact that mathematics crops up everywhere. And so it sort of was part of life. And so now I was... In fact, there's a whole set of things that you can make out of electromagnets. And after a while, you can think of more things that really you've got time to make out of electromagnets. But it happened that as I grew up, and just as I sort of started going into secondary school, it turned out that the transistor, which had been conveniently invented, you know, just as I was being born, more or less, the transistor started becoming available in large packets, in proofs at the Tottenham Court Road. So I go down Tottenham Court Road and buy these packets of untested transistors, which are basically failed test transistors, but the failed testing wasn't very good. We take them back and do our own tests and sort them into different sort of strengths of transistor, different levels of gain, and we put together these things called breadboards, where you stick in transistors and resistors and make circuits. And that actually you can make, start with, you can make things which oscillate much more quickly than the buzzer, so you can make more, you can make things make noises. You can make things which control a train layout. You can make things that will beep for a certain amount of time. You can make burglar alarms. And in fact, out of these transistors, you can make logic gates, which are very much like the relay, that they can, you know, they control more things from just one signal. And they can combine signals, so they'll turn on if you turn, if you have more, if you have any signal, for example, one or the other, it'll turn on. That's called an OR gate. Or if you build another circuit, which will turn on if all of it's this and this turn on, that's called an AND gate. And out of AND gates and OR gates and inverters, which just turn on when they're turn on when their input is off and vice versa, just to change the sense of something, you can actually build all logic circuits you can build, so you can, anything that you can imagine that's built out of on and off signals, you can make out of, if you want to, nails, but now transistors, you can turn these transistors into gates. And so after a while, I started to make things like I wanted to make an intercom with dialing. And as you do that, the number of transistors you need starts to get a bit, you know, you can do it, but you end up soldering a lot of transistors onto a lot of these circuits and making a lot of trips down the Tottenham Court Road to get more transistors. So fortunately, this is where, you know, this is why I'm so lucky. At that point, when my buddy Nick and I were building these things, and they were getting more and more complicated. And really, you know, building the gates was getting boring. You could now go down the Tottenham Court Road, and you could buy these little bugs. They're called because they look like little millipedes, about an inch long, with pins every 0.1 of an inch, pointing downwards. And each package of those, the 7400, had 4 NAND gates. And if you work it out, actually, you can make that anything in the world that uses binary logic out of NAND gates. So, in fact, if you had enough of these little 7400 bugs, then you could make... So that's much more efficient. So we knew, of course, because we'd made all these gates, so we knew exactly what was in them, because we made them out of transistors. We basically knew that if we had to, we could make... And if we couldn't get transistors, which were a bit magic, you always know kind of how the thing worked, because you knew you could make it out of nails and stuff. But now you could get these chips. And so I started building. I decided that it would be kind of nifty to have a computer. Building a computer was a bit out of the question. But in those days, computers were big things in racks, which had next to them terminals. So there was a screen, and a keyboard was... the thing that naturally you might think nowadays was a computer actually was just a terminal. So there's a thing like a TV with a few rows of print on it and a keyboard. So I decided that I would need one of those. So I started building the visual display unit. That's the thing that displays the characters. I got a TV from the place, the guy down the road, for £5. I went in there and sort of said, do you have any TVs where the video piece is working, but the radio piece for receiving television is broken? And the guy sort of rolled his eyes. He's a TV repairman. So sort of went out back and he said, you know, I've kind of got more than I'd like of those. Have as many as you like. So I took two. So I was up in my room in the attic trying to make this TV do stuff. First of all, by putting a signal in going quite slowly, which gives you horizontal bars, and then making oscillators which go faster and faster, and after a while you get vertical bars. And I actually had a feed of a signal going downstairs onto the hall table so that people could see how well I was getting on. And so I got, I come down to lunch and say, hey, you know, you got vertical bars. So, you know, is that better? So then I get vertical bars and go from vertical bars to horizontal bars, and then actually put a logic in to select one vertical bar. So I turn the video signal on just for one bar, and then just for one and then put in there a gate combining those signals that we're in this place and we're in this place, and then have just a block like a block cursor which could then be moved around by using a counter. And then after a while, this is by this time I'm getting to university, so now in a spare time on a university, I worked in a timber yard, and there was a skip where they'd thrown away this old calculating machine that had masses of buttons, and I took those out. And I got to the point where I'd got the whole thing working, except I needed to make what would have been a massive, great matrix of diodes to store the shape of each character. Everything, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. The thing has to look up when it gets the code for A, which ends in 1, and the code for B, which ends in 2 in binary. I had to convert that into the actual shape of a B. Now, either was going to... Now, for every dot, I would have had to solder in a diode. That was going to be an awful lot of dots. But, ta-da, I know, the right generation. Just at that point, you could get a thing called a character generator, which is a built-in, pre-made memory chip about that long. It seemed to cost a lot. I think, I remember, 13 quid, I was much more scared of breaking it than... maybe 13 quid was a lot then. I was frightened. These circuits were very delicate, and you could affect them with static electricity. So I did the whole operation of putting this thing into the board after I bought it, with the kettle going under the table, filling the place with steam, so that I wouldn't have any static electricity. So just at that point, this character generator came along, and so I took it into the lab in Oxford, to the skeptical lab, and actually got it to the point where it was actually a computer terminal. So that time I left Oxford, and I tested it on the computer at Oxford. How many years of working toward this goal of more and more complex things. That's just the terminal, right? Okay, it's got the display. It's got, you know, it's got the thing in the lid of the, what was you getting the laptop now? And in fact, I could have taken these 7400 series devices and actually made a computer, because actually I knew how a computer worked. A computer is actually pretty simple. It's got lots and lots of memory, and it's got a place. And it's got a little thing to work out on which operation it's going to do next. It doesn't do very many operations. There wouldn't be too many gates. And it has a program counter to work out which memory address it's going to take the instruction from next. And it's got an accumulator, which is where it keeps the number it's working on. And so it's not really... Actually, a computer is of finite complexity. It just is. Once you've figured out what's in a computer, then there are some more complicated ones you can get now. But they're all just equivalent to this really simple one. But I'm riding the crest of this wave, because there we are, just as I come to the end of my career by studying physics, by the way, which was fun too, but that's another story. Then it turns out that you could get this slightly longer chip with 40 pins on it, so 2 inches long, which has actually got a complete microprocessor in it. So this 6800 device came out, which had a very nice, beautiful little nice instruction set processor. So then I saved up, got the thing, and connected it up to memory to it, and connected it up to this to the visual display unit, to the terminal. And so just as I was even, so there I was, leaving 3 years of physics, which doesn't call you a physicist really, but I'd actually felt that I really understood how that computer worked. I programmed it in hexadecimal. Later, I wrote programming language with it, so I figured out, and there are a bunch of people I know who've got involved with these sorts of things in that, and they've gone through that same sort of stage, and they all know that they all got that feeling when they look at a computer that actually, they know what's inside it.
Right, okay, that was Tim Berners-Lee with just a little intro to the really. I've mentioned in the chat, Tim Berners-Lee is one of my very rare heroes. I can only think of maybe three or maybe four scientists who I now legitimately count among my great inspirations. And Tim Berners-Lee is definitely pretty high on that list. Essentially there, what he was describing was how he progressed from growing up in a family of mathematicians, surrounded by logic gates and the mathematics around those sort of devices, that he began experimenting with basic electromechanics to do switching, and then soon realised that these new transistors that had just been invented would do it even quicker, even better, and then progressing from the transistors to the integrated circuits, which then became available. And so essentially by the time that the computer revolution was in its very infancy, he was already incredibly well equipped to not only be able to understand the coding language, but also to actually understand how that coding language ran on the actual hardware that it was written for. And this is really crucial to Tim's position and the sort of history. One thing that Tim doesn't mention there, I suspect that the reason why his parents were so deeply embedded within computing is, in fact, again, to do with another one of my very rare heroes, a man by the name of Tommy Flowers, who was the telephone engineer, the telephone systems engineer, working at the post office, as it was in those days, on their telephone exchanges. And he was the first to suggest using valves at the time as the machine switching for telephone exchanges, rather than having a single telephone operator there with a patchboard in front of her manually selecting the phone calls. This would enable machine routing, of course, which is just we take for granted now. But his work on the machine logic for those telephone exchanges led to him realizing that many of World War II war efforts, mathematical problems, could be solved much more quickly if they used a computer and used machine logic and things like Boolean logic hardwired into a programmable computer. Now, when Tommy was postulating this by way of programmable computer, yes, the Colossus was going to be a programmable computer, but the programs would be written in exactly the same way that the old telephone exchange operators would have to take an incoming call and then route that call straight through to its direct mechanical socket. And this meant that the actual programs for the Colossus weren't written on any paper tape or on any sort of magnetic disc. They were in fact woven onto enormous patch boards, almost like a 2 foot square of usually some sort of insulator board. And the wires would literally, for the programs, would literally be hardwired into these boards. And they actually had to employ old grannies to do it, because they were the only ones with the manual dexterity to actually accomplish this on any sort of reliable task. And so essentially what became the Colossus, what became the first ever, world's first ever machine programmable computer, when I began investigating computer science, again, one of these sort of odd synchronicities that seems to happen to me far too often for it to be possibly chance. But as I'm discovering about this top secret development of the Colossus and of Tommy Flowers' part that he played in it, I discover a photo online of Tommy Flowers in the Dollis Hill telephone exchange of its day, and it turned out to be the very workshop that I happened to be working in at the time in the video industry. He was in fact standing in front of the very window that I worked under every single day of the week, which put a bit of a chill down my spine. In fact, there's a little—I found out there's a little close in the middle of that particular estate called Flowers Close, which was named in his memory. And essentially, what happened after the war was there had been—I think it was 5 Colossuses built in total during the war. One of them was shipped to America. One of them was shipped to Russia. We had a couple here in the code-breaking departments and the projectile trajectory departments. And under Churchill's orders, the British ones were, reduced to the size that could be posted through a letterbox, according to Churchill. And so effectively, it was made so top secret that it was considered to be so crucial to the country's security that nobody should find out how we cracked the German secret codes, that we actually destroyed all of the hardware that we used to crack those codes. And so consequently, the American military foundations that received our Colossuses went on to become the very foundations of the very computer revolution I'm now about to go on to talk about. So that sort of puts it into its historical complex. So now let's define the Googleplex. I mean, that in and of itself sounds a bit of an odd word. I mean, there is actually a place, if you Google Googleplex, you will find that the Google headquarters is in fact called the Googleplex. But the Googleplex I'm referring to isn't the Googleplex of Google headquarters. The Googleplex that I'm referring to is essentially all of the hardened soft structures. That is the hardware that the network is carried on, the servers, the telephone wires, the exchanges, the hubs, the routers, the computers, and your laptops and handheld devices. And also, to some degree, the soft structures are the people in that particular little machine, including all of the staff and the employees at all of the various ISPs and at Google and all of the various IT companies, but also us as users. We are the soft structures of the Googleplex. And what I'm hoping to present to you this evening is the concept of the Googleplex as the global mind, and try and present to you at least a reasonable amount of evidence that its very existence is pseudo-organic, and due to my personal belief systems that suggest that there is nothing that is not natural, that is of and from nature, and certainly the internet and all of its structures are of and from nature, even if they've come through our hands, that it's not that surprising that it appears, as it gets more and more complex, to be replicating some of the structures of the human brain. Only in its replication of those structures, instead of having a synapse at the end of each, instead of having a synapse with like one input terminal and five output terminals, the Googleplex's mind has a synapse that is effectively an entire human at every node, and it has billions of them. And so the ability of the Googleplex, of the global mind, is going to be inconceivable even to our own minds. We can't imagine what it's likely to be capable of should we begin to tend it a little more carefully. But this is humans need not apply. This is a discussion of AI.
Delighted to have Jerry Kaplan with us tonight. His book, Humans Need Not Apply, Candid Call to Arms, is a phrase that Jerry's used for bold ideas to ease the transition through the next industrial revolution. Jerry is widely known as an entrepreneur, an innovator, an author, and a futurist. He founded a number of Silicon Valley startups. So this is his second, if not his third, career. Jerry Kaplan.
What we're doing in artificial intelligence is we're building increasingly intelligent machines. And these are becoming more and more intelligent. And sometime soon, they might surpass human capabilities. And when they do that, they're going to start to steal our jobs and possibly even escape human control. And then they're going to take over the world. Now, I'm going to present the case today that narrative is basically very misguided and, in fact, counterproductive for solving the kinds of social problems that the field is actually going to create. Consider how machines and people learn. Now, you can teach a computer to recognize a cat by showing it a million images, or you can simply point one out to a three-year-old. That's a cat. And it gets the same job done. Obviously, humans and machines do not learn in the sense of these programs the same way. So what is artificial intelligence really? Can't they solve all kinds of complex reasoning and perception problems? Well, the answer is sure. They can perform tasks that humans solve using intelligence. But that doesn't mean that the machines themselves are intelligent. It merely means that many tasks that we thought required general intelligence are in fact subject to solution by other more mechanical means. These autonomous vehicles, they drive cars. They don't do other things. Robots really don't have any independent goals and desires. A robot that's designed to wash and fold laundry, it might be plenty sophisticated, but it's not going to wake up one day and say, "Oh my God, what a fool I've been. I really want to play the great concert halls of Austria." That's not what we're doing. Now, I want to talk about the consequences of taking this more mundane view of what artificial intelligence is. It's certainly true that artificial intelligence is going to have a serious impact on labor markets and on employment, but perhaps not exactly in the way that you expect. Machines and computers don't actually perform jobs. They automate tasks. Now, except in extreme cases, you don't roll in a robot and show the person to the door and kick them to the curb. If your job requires a human touch, such as expressing sympathy or providing companionship, you know, I don't think you really have very much to worry about. Even experts, lawyers and doctors and accountants and all that, spend most of their time doing mundane tasks. These are repetitive tasks, like they review lab test results or the lawyers draft simple contracts. And many of these intellectual and physical tasks require straightforward logic or simple hand-eye coordination of some kind. There are a bunch of new technologies that are poised to automate a lot of these routine tasks. Automation, whether it's driven by artificial intelligence or not, changes the skills that are necessary to perform that work. So what are the jobs of the future? These are demonstrations of skill or person-to-person interactions. That's the good news. But the bad news is it takes time for these transitions to happen. And there's another dark cloud that relates to advances in artificial intelligence. While it's true that automation actually makes society richer, there are very serious questions about whose pockets are filled by that increased wealth. As economists know, automation is the substitution of capital for labor. The struggle between capital and labor is a losing proposition for workers. What that means is that the benefits of the new automation naturally accrue to those who can invest in the new systems. And the problem that we have is that our economic policies and our regulatory policies have been decoupled from our social goals. We don't have to steal from the rich and give to the poor. What we need to do is to provide the proper incentives for entrepreneurs and businesses to find better ways to benefit a larger swath of society. Our technology and our economy should serve us, not the other way around. Thank you very much.
All right, let me just start with this, and I'll dive straight in. I've got a 10-year-old daughter. What should I be telling her to do as in her profession?
That's a really good question. This is one upsmanship. I have four daughters. Two of them just got their first jobs. And the peculiar thing about this is that neither of the jobs that they got existed 10 years ago. One of them is does social media promotion for restaurants in San Francisco. And the other one works at a company called Udacity. It's an online education company. Didn't exist 10 years ago. And they're just right out of college, right out of school. You know what they're looking for now at companies like Udacity? They don't expect people to have any experience in what they're doing. They look for a broad liberal arts education. What you want to do for a 10-year-old is make sure that they learn good critical thinking skills. And then we have to stop thinking about education as you go along, you get some general education, then you learn a profession, and you're stuck in that profession for the rest of your life. We have to begin to think of education as an ongoing process of retraining.
These are problems that you are raising. Do policymakers get this?
Generally, I think the answer is no. The only light on the horizon in this, at least in the U.S., is that both major political parties understand now that income inequality and wealth inequality is a real problem. Now, you have to talk about the time frames, though. In the short run, it's just like what happened during the Industrial Revolution. Oh, great, now we have machines that can weave,
And, you know, the weavers are all starving, and it's the same thing. It's just a modern version of that same process. The question is, do we want to change the policies to make a more humane path to a better future?
Fascinating things. So thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much.
Jerry Kaplan, everyone.
Thank you.
I'm a little bit concerned that it's already getting on for the first hour, and I'm going to really struggle to get all this in even before 4 a.m. So let's plow ahead. Right, it's a little unfortunate that I slipped on the button there and cued the wrong audio first, because, like I say, I am trying to assemble this sequentially and effectively lead you by the nose through a subject that may be on the surface quite complex. But in fact, when you pull apart each of the component parts that went to construct the structure itself that you're studying, it turns out that really they're not anything like what you may think that they are, and certainly weren't arrived at in anything like the manner in which you may think that they're arrived at. So again, rather than listening to my dulcet tones, let's listen again to the rather excitable Tim Berners-Lee. And this is him describing precisely how he invented the World Wide Web and precisely how it ended up released into the wild, accidentally, almost, says he.
So that, to that point, I went into the, I suppose, hardware, software consulting business, but went to work for Plessy, went down to South Coast, went and spent quite a lot of time working with my buddy Kev here, where we understood how these microprocessors worked, and lots of people in the hardware field who designed massive racks and racks and racks of electronics of different, using different sort of technology, which is stuck at these various different points. And now you could replace the whole thing with a microprocessor. There was this huge open field of people who knew how you could do things with microprocessors, and I had a lot of fun going anywhere. So we wanted more or less to. Taking out huge amounts of hardware and putting in software. So the things that Kev and I did, some of the things we did was we did with printers. We took printers and made them smarter. So we put fonts in them. We put communications protocols in them. We did page layout. And we did macroprocessor limited languages. And we wrote an operating system at one point. So we did all kinds of stuff. And so by the time I arrived at CERN, I was really frustrated with the documentation of systems. I'd got all the things I needed to design the web that I designed because I needed it. I was just frustrated that it didn't exist. Most of the trouble was persuading people it would be a good idea and not too complicated and worth investing their time in. And so that's the story of how I got there. So I feel to a certain extent, yes, we of that generation were in this, you know, the fact that we followed the new technology, every time we got to the end of an episode, there was the cake already, you know, that had been cooked in the oven. And now that you've learned how to do it yourself the hard way, now you can get lots, as many as you want, the cheap way. So I think that was a really sort of amazing thing, sort of wave to surf in on. And so there we were, and there I was with the tools to create this web thing. And the reason I told you that whole story is I want you to realize that programming computers, you know, that I want to try and transmit some of what I got from my parents, that programming computers is really, really creative. And what's disappointing now is that a lot of kids in school, the way they meet the computer is not by the same path. They meet the computer like they meet a fridge. It's a white thing, but it's white goods. You open it, you do stuff with it. It has on it Word. It has on it, a spreadsheet. It has on it the web, which for a lot of them is, a lot of them open it. Google Facebook login, take the first thing, log into Facebook, and that is what they know of the web, and that is what they know of the computer. That is their world. And they don't know that they've used a search engine, and they don't know that they've used the web, and they don't really know that they've used a computer, apart from the, like, you know. And they don't know that if they could imagine the computer doing something different, that they could program it. So the other thing I wanted to say is that actually, that when you start connecting the computers together, it's very different. The product design is very different, because all that sort of design that you do with sort of building a little mousetrap to fire a gun at your brother. It's like designing a mousetrap in that if you make a better one, you can use it straight away and you can sell it to other people. But now, When you do something on the web, if you design a protocol, like you design, say, the email, suppose you design an email system, you can't just write an email system and set it running on your computer. It's no good unless other people have them. It's like telephones. It's got Metcalfe's law applies that it's the value of one of these things is proportional to somehow positively, monotonically related to the number of the ones out there. So that if there's no one, it's very difficult selling the first one. You have to sell it to people who just believe it or relate it or think you're nuts. But certain sets of people who get the gleam in their eye. If everybody did this, it would be really cool. There are certain type of people, under those circumstances, where there's something where if everybody did it, it would be really cool. They'll do it anyway. No, they will do it. The early adopters. And in a network, building a network of anything, you need those early adopters. So getting that, that is because when you're building something big, it's not just the technical design either. Everything that's been done over the internet, like the design email, it's both a technical design and a social design. Email was designed before I came along. The web is 20 years old, the internet is 40 years old, and somewhere between those 20 and 40 years back, somebody designed email, and they designed email for a system where computers would pass information packages between them, like postcards, and everybody would program their computer to happily look after other people's mail and pass it on, because it was an academic environment and everybody was friends. And when the messages arrived, people would read them because it's an academic environment. If somebody's going to go to the trouble of writing me a message, then I'm certainly going to go to the trouble of reading it. So the system was designed for a social setup, which didn't hold when there were millions of consumers online and when you're allowed to use it for commercial purposes. And suddenly the whole system basically broke. For a lot of people, when spam came, a lot of people just went back to the phone. A lot of people, and for a lot of people now, if they don't have good spam protection, they find email unusable. So when you think about how you design a system, like the web, why does the web work? It works because people follow links. People can only follow links if people make links. Why do people make links? People make links because you make links from your page because you want your page to be a better quality page. You want it to be a better quality page because you want more people to read it. You want people to read it because maybe you want the ads. Maybe you want the kudos. It was all originally done on kudos before you could get ad revenue. So it's the psychology of people wanting to be read that makes them make links to other good things. And when they make links to other good things, then they, by doing that, they're actually voting for those other good things. And the links themselves form this huge mass of critical review, which is actually how the web works. And the search engines aren't smart. They just use that massive critical review put in by human beings. So the search engines all rely on those links critically. So it's all about people. The system is a social technical thing, and the design of the technology and the design of the social piece of it absolutely intimately linked. And if you want to design a new social networking site, or you want to design a new protocol, or you want to design a new peer-to-peer thing, or a new instant chat, or whatever it is, whatever you're just about to think of, okay, you're designing a human system mediated by technology. And it looks as though you're designing a piece of technology. You're designing a new way two computers can talk across the internet, but really it's not interesting unless it ends up designing a new system. The reason I say it's not like designing a mousetrap is that when you design the small system, it is completely different. It's a system that links how two people talk, or how two people, one can put something up for auction, another person can bid on it. You design that as a microscopic thing. As a result, with eBay, eBay did work. So the result is you get this macroscopic phenomenon that there is an open market for all kinds of second-hand junk, which probably had a huge economic effect on raising the value of second-hand junk and lowering the cost of second-hand junk to the people who need it. So eBay then, apart from making a few people pretty rich, it actually made a lot of people's lives easier. And it allowed lots of things to happen, and it changed the economy because it produced a system which just which spread because it worked and it was good. One of the things that concerns me now is we all use the web, we all rely on it, and we're all actually, as people, we're intimately connected in with all kinds of systems. A lot of us, you know, we come here and we sit in this teepee, which is very nice, and it's very, you know, it's very much rock and stone and back to the elements and stuff. But we, you know, we all used maps on our, you know, in our cars, which from and satellite data to get here, and we looked it up on the web, and we probably found lots of stuff about it on the web, and we, you know, and we got here directly through email. So we're very much connected, and a lot of our jobs depend on this web thing, and a lot of things the way people vote depends a lot on this web thing. Whether people believe in science or cult religion depends on this web thing. And we don't really study it. So we know that the emergent phenomena which happen out there on the web, so the, you know, whether the thing, the, what's trending, the fact that things trend on Twitter and decay, are all a result of the things that we've been doing on a microscopic scale. But we haven't really got any mathematics. We haven't got people studying the web as a big thing. So, if you're the younger generation, if you maybe grew up not realizing this computer was something which you should, must start programming right away, maybe you should use what you've, use your creativity and your and all the brain power you possibly throw at, not just looking at a computer, because now you've got a responsibility to now look at this big thing, the web. It's actually, now there are as many web pages out there, there are 10 to the power 11, that's as many neurons as in your brain, the web. If you could take it in, I could bring it down here and bring it down to brain size. It's a very complex thing. It's not the shape of a brain. We don't understand it. We don't know what shape it really is. I don't have any pictures of it. And we don't understand whether it's actually going to be stable in the future. So, those are the two things I wanted to tell you. Okay, that computers are a lot of fun and you should program them. But that when you program them and connect them together, it's not like programming one computer. You have to think about the whole mass of 10 to the power 11 things. And that's, of course, why it's so fun and exciting. Thanks.
The wonderful Tim Berners-Lee again there. I can't impress on you enough just how important and how key this man has been to the very devices that you're hearing my voice through to this very day. And many of the devices that Lee spent the last 2 hours trying to broadly encourage people to be wary of. I wouldn't necessarily say that Lee is ever one to encourage fear in anybody, but certainly a degree of caution. What I'm trying to present tonight is, to some degree, the contrary to that. It's a presentation hoping to encourage everybody that the thing that we fear from our ignorance, in our understanding, we become the masters of, and that this is largely what the essence of tonight's show is, if you're wondering where this was all going, is to turn the listening audience from the... we're all kind of afraid of the word ignorance, but I tend to use it in a very broad sense. Ignorance simply means the lack of knowledge, okay? And the lack of knowledge breeds fear, and fear breeds violence. So the first objective of the Omniversity is to reduce general levels of common ignorance, to reduce levels of fear and consequently reduce levels of violence amongst the society that we're all forced to share. In that respect, I feel that one of the most fundamental forces in society to this day is the computer. It has been something that I've grown up around, but not with. I was from far too poor a family to join in on the initial stages of the computer revolution, and it was only when I got together with my partner of 20 years that one of her relatives was upgrading their work PC, and the rate of change in that day and age had essentially made their incredibly expensive business PC of 2 years before effectively obsolete. And so I acquired this effectively obsolete PC with effectively obsolete software on it and a cheap crappy modem and one of the first dial-up lines available, and joined the internet community in 1996. So I speak to you as somebody who really has seen the computer revolution literally evolve in front of my eyes, and as somebody who I went to pains to point out in the show with Nick on New Year's Eve, I have spent an entire lifetime investigating the sciences and their sort of their mechanisms, how they work together. And the computer revolution is one that I've followed intensely closely, to the degree where, you know, I mean, I would be reading New Scientist articles about the patterns of the new chip layouts that were going to enable things like the Pentium processors to become available. And so in my lifespan, I have gone from the only computer that I knew of was the Ford mainframe, and the only reason why I knew of it was because my mother happened to work at a grammar school as the school secretary, and at that grammar school had, because of its connections with the Ford Motor Company, had one of the very few external terminals on the Ford's mainframe. And effectively this terminal was a remote terminal hardwired in that they'd had to lay the cables in from the Ford's research institute to this particular school, some distance of about 15 or 17 miles, which is not an inconceivable feat and certainly far too expensive for most people to consider. And this is actually quite a good analogue of exactly how the internet came about, and that's essentially what I'm going to proceed to present to you as we move on. Now, I know that we're short on time, but it's always good for me to put these tune breaks in here and there, because they help me to collect my thoughts. I do have show notes, remarkably, for this evening. I certainly wouldn't have ever done my Freeman Jack shows with show notes. That was almost against the very principle of the damn thing. But I'm hoping to do a far more academic and responsible approach to my broadcast as the Omniversity. So let's have a bit of Massive Attack and Paradise Circus just to collect the thoughts. Okay, so let's just discuss this thing that is the internet. First of all, what is it? Well, let's simplify it back to, I was just referring to my days, very first days on the internet in 1996. And because of the very basic nature of the internet in the pre-search engine days, I was actually on Windows 3.1, which wasn't even what's known as a graphical user interface. It was a DOS command box interface before you ever got to any graphical bits. Essentially, the internet of those days was a peer-to-peer nodal system which had almost organically evolved from DARPANET to ARPANET and into the World Wide Web as we know it through Tim's programming skills. And what Tim had actually invented with the www bit was a way of getting around the problem that the only way of accessing information over the emerging internet at the time was through lists of preferred web pages and their IP addresses, which was a set of numbers. And essentially, if you knew the IP address of the computer that held the file that you were wanting to access, then you could ping that computer, and providing that the file was on the public domain side of that computer, then that computer would effectively act as the file server and deliver that file to your computer through your phone line. And that there was effectively no central control of this. Your local modem, once you had your telephone line converted to an ISDN, which is an international asymmetric data, asynchronous data network, no, whatever. Anyway, one of those. Once you'd had your telephone line converted from a pure voice signal to being able to carry data at all, this now facilitated your ability to literally dial phone numbers through your local exchange. This was effectively the beauty of the internet, was that it was invented to be unbreakable. It was basically invented to survive a nuclear attack, and that was in the prerequisite for the creation of it. But the hardware alone and the sort of clunky connection methods of the pre-search engine days effectively left this as a hardware system simply for individuals to file share and send emails and sort of instant messages and the likes. So the first of the search engines really arrived with Google in 1997. Google effectively went and searched the internet, searched all of those known IP addresses, which all had to be registered to a central IP addressing system. And lots of these have spawned up in the sort of digital age, and this is certainly an issue for security, is exactly who issues the IP addresses and who controls which IP addresses are issued. Again, largely that's under our own control, and still the internet is effectively unbreakable. Even if the main structures that supports the internet now were to completely fail, it would not be an entire impossibility for those of us with the technical know-how to recreate a phoenix out of the flames and resurrect an internet, if not the internet, and allow what we know today to continue in some respects. In some ways, I'd actually like to encourage people to look into the possibility of turning their... Lee was busy trying to tell everybody to turn their Wi-Fi off. I'd actually like to encourage people to leave their bloody Wi-Fi on and try and learn how some way to make it a throughput node on a private network. There's actually a German crew that have made an app for your mobile phone, and this basically turns your mobile phone into a private peer-to-peer networking node where the traffic going through your phone will not be able to be detected by your phone. You won't be able to read that traffic if it's not intended for you. If it's not got your metadata on it, you can't read it. But in enabling this app, you enable your phone as a node on this private network, and it effectively becomes a private internet. And this has become quite popular, and certainly in many German cities now it's actually apparently singing along quite nicely, even though we don't get to hear much about it. So people are working on these subjects. So let's look into what is a search engine. Okay, so we just discussed that a search engine is essentially a collator of the material that is on the internet. So basically a search engine goes to all of those servers, all of those computers and private networks which have a public domain. These things are known as demilitarized zones. Your router will actually have settings for you to enable a DMZ on your network. And if you enable a DMZ, what you're basically doing is you're allowing a open door into some part of your network. I wouldn't go messing with those controls unwittingly, but certainly it is something that you do. That if you've got a large number of files that you know are difficult to get hold of on the network, it's very easy to turn a very small old scrap laptop with a broken screen into a small file server, make sure that it's got none of your personal data on it, and then direct your DMZ settings on your router to direct public traffic to that. And if you allow the bots and the spiders to access your files and folders as well, then your files and folders will become visible to the likes of Google and Yahoo and Bing. Okay, so Google was the first. Effectively, Google became the best because it was the first. Essentially, the other search engines really rely on Google, so they are important to a degree, but essentially because they have to refer to Google in order to acquire a lot of the data that they rely on, effectively without Google the two main ones wouldn't work either. So we've got Google. It's a thing. It is what it is. I tend to see Google as a bit of a neutral corporation personally, certainly from their actions rather than their words or any suspicions about their deeds, appear to be largely beneficial, largely benevolent even. I mean, I don't know if you know, but Google's company motto is "Don't be evil," and they've got it in huge, like 2-foot-high letters on their headquarter wall. And certainly, as far as Google's business model, it's an incredibly holistic model, and very different to the majority of corporate sort of advertising revenue derived corporate finances. And essentially with Google, what you have is a model where, because of the amount of data that they carry on the amount of internet traffic, where people are going, what they're looking at, how long they're looking at it for. And this doesn't mean that they have your personal details as such. This is just simply carried on the metadata, which is able to be read by every single device that the data passes through. But this is not your data. This is simply the packet data. This is simply to tell the network where your packet has got to go. And once it gets there, the computer that receives it sends a little "got it" message, and that has to come back through that network the same and tell your computer, yeah, okay, that packet arrived, okay, send the next one. That's a little bit of an oversimplification, but that's largely how network traffic works. So, essentially, so how does a search engine present you with a page of information? Well, they use something called the search engine algorithm. Sounds very complicated, but effectively what it is a bunch of very clever maths. And its cleverness is actually, again, I would suggest, one of the things that lends it to openness and to being very difficult to tamper with any great degree of effectiveness. That effectively this mathematics is so intricate, it's so crystalline almost in its uniformity, in its ability to be uniform, that any attempt to alter it in any fundamental way, despite what the next speaker is actually going to say about the Google algorithm having been fundamentally modified recently, I would suggest that the actual algorithm that Google relies on cannot be fundamentally altered. So what they will have done is they will have put additional filtering algorithms as almost like an overcoat over the existing very special Google algorithm. And effectively, this algorithm uses what are known as bots and spiders. As scary as that may sound, these are simply little bits of software that go out and ping every IP address that's registered in the IP libraries. And if it's a private IP, then it won't respond. It will ignore that ping, or it won't send any data back anyway. It will just simply know I'm close to business, and the Google bot will go away. If you, however, have one of these public demilitarized zones on your server, and your IP address for that data is listed on one of the public domains, then the Google bot will discover your web page. It will analyze all of the words that are publicly available there, all of the words that are written on the page, and it will use some very clever maths to basically page rank that for its qualities and its quantities and its reliability. Now, it's probably best that... let's play what is Google's algorithm here. Again, quite quickly spoken, but I'm trying to fit an awful lot in tonight, and I did my very best to find the most eloquent speakers on each subject. So rather than spend an hour trying to tell you something myself, it's much easier to get these legitimate insiders giving you the real inside skinny from the mouth of the insider, from the people that are actually doing this stuff for real, not just sort of scaremongering about it. And let them speak for themselves. So this is now... I can't see the chap's name. I think he says it for himself, but this is what is Google's algorithm.
Everybody, Alex Shaker here. Today I'm going to talk about SEO. This talk is really about how to get found on Google and to capture more leads. So first, I want to define what search engine optimization is. It's the process of affecting the visibility of a website or web page in the organic or unpaid search results of Google, Yahoo, Bing, and the other search engines. So let me show you what that is. When you first do a search on Google, for example, in this case, I did a search on auto repair shops in Dover, Delaware. What you're gonna see is a page something like this. These results here in red are ads. These are not organic results. So in other words, these are merchants that are paying to be here. These merchants that are at the top are paying more than these merchants that are on the side. This portion in green is the key. This is the organic search results. this is where most of the people click on the website to see what it is. And typically this will have 10 results. In this particular case, there's some results here which are from Google Places. These results are more and more common from Google depending on what your search term is. Typically it's for services. I'm going to talk more about that later on in other videos. Now, I want to show you some statistics and why it's so important to be on the first page and a particular position on the first page. This is a chart from Chatika, which is an ad platform similar to Google AdWords. Now, what you'll notice here is page one gets about 91.5% of the traffic. Page two gets about 5%, and all the other pages take the bits and scraps that are left over. So do you see why it's important to be on the first page? If you're not on the first page, you're missing 90% of the traffic. That's where almost everybody goes. So it's very important to be on the first page. Now, there's a second factor that's also important, and that is the placement on that page. So this is another chart by Chatika, and it shows you the importance of being in first place, second place, third place, etc. So if your website is ranked first on the first page of Google, it's in the first position, you're going to get roughly 32% of all the traffic that's going to that page. If you're in the number two position, you'll get about 17%. Number three, about 12%, and so on. So you start to see that the traffic goes down drastically after the sixth or seventh position. And then when you get to the second position, the second page, which is the 11th position and beyond, it becomes really low. So this is where you want to be. I want to talk a little bit about how search engines work. By talking about this, it'll give you the perspective on why it is that we do what we do and what you need to do to get your website ranked. Now, the way search engines work is search engines are essentially a computer program. It's a computer program that searches the web for sites based on the keyword that you're using. So whatever keyword that you've entered, Google is going to go out and it's going to search the entire web for sites based on that particular keyword, and it'll return a list of sites that it deems most relevant to that keyword. So how does this work? Well, their mission is really to get you the best, most relevant results that are as precise as possible regarding what they think you are looking for. And the reason they want to do that is so that you keep coming back to them, so you bring them all your business, and they want you to click on their ads because that's essentially how they make money. Whenever you click on the ads in Google, that's how they make most of their money. Same thing with Bing and Yahoo. They want you to keep coming back because you got great results and you got exactly what you're looking for. Early search engines didn't quite work this way. They were little more than listings of favorite websites or directories of websites. If you had a new website, you would enter your information in these search engines, and you, the visitor, would determine what category your website fell under. Or you would submit your website and a human being would determine what category or what lists your website should belong to. That's certainly not the way search engines work today. And this all changed back in 1996 when two guys working on their PhD at Stanford had an insight. What these two guys saw is that when they were working on their PhD thesis and when they were looking at other research papers, at the end of the research paper, there was a bibliography. Now, this bibliography has citations and references that support the information that they are presenting in their own paper. And the way it works in that world is that the more papers that refer back to a particular citation, so for example, if there's a bunch of other papers that are referring back to a particular citation, in this case, George Bibby, then George Bibby's paper becomes very authoritative because a lot of different people are referring back to it, meaning that this paper has some important information. It must have something very authoritative and important to say. So these guys thought, well, why not use the same concept for websites? So for example, why not rank the authority or importance of a website based on the number of citations that that website has on other websites? And this concept became known as PageRank. And the two guys who invented this concept are guys by the name of Sergey Brin and Larry Page. And as you might have guessed, these are the founders of Google. So now you kind of know the rest of the story. That's where the concept of PageRank came from. And that's how, even today, a large part of Google's algorithm is based on this concept. Let me give you an example of how Google works. If the entire universe of websites consisted of these 11 websites, this is how they would look to Google. The larger the circle, the more important, the higher their ranking and the higher the page rank is. The smaller the circle, the lower their page rank is. And this number represents the overall page rank. So let's look at this. For example, B is the highest ranked website here. Now, why is that? That's because all these websites, almost every website in our small universe here is pointing to it. You take a look at C. You notice with C that there's only one website referring to it, and this website is referring back. Now, the reason this is still considered a high PageRank site is because this particular website has very high PageRank and it's referring to it. So the way PageRank works is it not only looks at the number of different websites that are referring back to your website, but it also looks at the authority or how authoritative those websites are that are referring back to you. And that, in a nutshell, is kind of like how Google PageRank works. Now, why do I keep talking about Google? Because I want you to understand what a big footprint Google has. This tells you a little bit about the current search engine traffic. So about 2/3 of all the traffic in the world goes through Google. Bing and Yahoo are the other major search engines, and then the rest are 4 or 5%. Now, there's also some data supporting that Google is even bigger than this is, because data shows that people who go to Yahoo and Bing go to Google first. So I believe that Google is even more important than what this chart shows. So any SEO company that doesn't pay attention to Google, that knows intimately what Google's trying to do, is really not doing their job, in my opinion. Now, let's talk a little bit more about how Google works. Google catalogs the World Wide Web, and they use this by using what's called a spider. A spider is basically a program that crawls the internet. Spiders go to various websites. So if you have a website, a Google spider is going to come to that website. It's going to scan and assess the content of the pages. It's going to look at the code. It's going to look at all the tags, the meta tags, and what have you. And then it's going to take that information and bring it back to Google's mainframe computers. They index this content, bring it back to the mainframe computers. And in those mainframe computers at Google, Google analyzes all the websites. It's going to analyze your website using a very complex computer algorithm and formula to determine what your search engine placement would be. So it's going to put all kinds of weightings on different factors of your website. It's going to look at all the backlinks that you have, the social signals, and a bunch of other stuff that I'm going to talk about in a minute, and determine where your website should rank on their search engine. The algorithm is the key to cracking Google, right? So if you knew the algorithm, you could determine how to rank in Google. We do know that the algorithm is highly sophisticated. It's been significantly upgraded and honed in the past 24 months. I mean, it's been around for years, but it's been significantly upgraded. They're using artificial intelligence in addition to rote formulas and algorithms to determine where your website should rank. The precise formula is a closely guarded secret. It's kind of like the formula for Coke, which is only known by two people in the world. It's kept in a vault somewhere in Switzerland. And those two people who know the formula don't ever travel together. Google's formula is kind of like that. Sergey Brin and Larry Page probably know the formula, but there's not too many other people that know the formula. Even within Google, there's probably only a handful of people who know precisely what the entire formula is. Here's Google's formula. This is not their mathematical formula. It is the factors that they use in ranking your website. So let me read it. Google rewards high quality websites with compelling, relevant, and dynamic content that people stay to read or view, come back to over and over again, and share on their social networks, and that other good sites refer to. Okay, it's a little bit complicated, so let me read it again. Google rewards high-quality websites with compelling, relevant, and dynamic content that people stay to read or view, come back to over and over again, share on their social networks, and that other good sites refer to. Now, if you do all this for your website, I guarantee you that your website is going to rank high. Now, what I'm going to talk about in the next video is I'm going to pick apart each one of these elements in Google's formula and tell you exactly what that means and tell you exactly what you need to do on your website.
Okay, so there's search engines in a nutshell. I think there's a concise speaker on that particular subject, and certainly, like I say, speaking as an insider on the inside subject. As you can see there, if you need to know about Google, really, just you need to just simply go to the terms and conditions and their kind of public presence. Okay, so I'd just like to take this into the realm of open source software. Some of you may be aware of the existence of open source software. Perhaps you might have used freeware in the past on your Microsoft computers or your Macs. But bend your knees and prepare for a shock, guys. The internet runs on Linux, and Linux is open source. The very nature of open source software is the contrary to closed source software, the likes of which the proprietary code underneath Windows and the Mac operating system, the OS X operating system, is proprietary code that you're not allowed to see what it does, which basically means if, like Tim, you're a code bunny and can actually read and write this stuff, effectively open source software allows you to actually read the machine code. Now, while that chap was going to great lengths to point out the grave secret of the Google algorithm, I would suggest that it's actually not that great a secret. It's maths from again, I think it was another French mathematician, this time from the 1940s, who basically created an addition to Boolean logic and created the sort of logic maths that's required for the sort of the Google web interface to work. Now, that's their private side, that's their not demilitarized zone. However, Google has another face, let's say, a public face that we're all very familiar with the Google search engine that you can pull up on any browser, and specifically with the Google Chrome browser that's recently come about, and the Google Chrome Books. Well, Google Chrome Book is a Linux device. It's actually specifically a Linux kernel with a Chrome interface put over the top of the Linux kernel, entirely open source. So if you want to go and read the code that the Chromebook runs on, unlike your Microsoft device, you can go and look and see what that machine is doing, if you understand what the code refers to. And this is exactly the same with the Chrome browser. Indeed, the Linux open source community have taken the Chrome browser and decided that it wasn't good enough for them, and they have something called the Chromium browser, which is all of the code lifted out of the Chrome browser, as you can do under open source software, and with a slightly different overcoat put over it. And again, this is just something completely inconceivable to the likes of Mac or Microsoft. Again, worth pointing out here that there's not really any need for antivirus software on a Linux machine, simply because there's no known viruses in the wild for Linux as yet. Essentially, the permission system within the Linux operating system almost precludes the ability for a virus to go viral, and so there's effectively not the same encouragement there to produce anyone to even desire to go and do it. A few of them apparently have been tried in the lab and they kind of worked, but again, this would mean getting all sorts of Linux users just to completely ignore everything they know about computer and web security for any of it to work, which is frankly never going to happen. Your average Linux user is a lot more canny about their intentional use of the computer than your average Microsoft or Mac user. Okay, so we're moving on to from web browsers to the people that use them, and I was fortunate enough to be the AV tech doing the audio and the video playthrough for a lecture by a Bristol University lecturer in computer sciences, and his seminar specifically was about metadata and the sort of way that the internet uses metadata in order to rank pages. And certainly I can't encourage you, any of you out there that have your own web pages or use YouTube or Google for whatever reason, the importance of meta tagging. Essentially, meta tags are the way that Google, it's like a shorthand for Google to find and rank pages. And effectively, if you don't bother to meta tag on YouTube, you will not appear in the recommendations. The only thing that will ever get you into those recommendations is simply the title of your piece. So unless you bother to meta tag, then you won't get found. So if you're YouTubing and you're not getting much attention, it's probably that your meta tags are pants. Essentially, with meta tags, what you're trying to do is you're trying to find the keywords that anybody is likely to be searching for who you will want to direct to your particular piece of information. So you think of all of the keywords, the core words, that are likely to be used in context of the subject, and you include those, including your name, your organisation, etc., etc., and all of the core subjects, like biology or physics in my case, into those meta tags in order that your material might actually be found and recommended through the algorithm, because this is not a conscious thing. The Google algorithm is not a conscious AI. This whole concept of AI, I hope that that earlier speaker really put the whole idea of AI to bed. Artificial intelligence is impossible. What is possible is something more akin to synthetic intelligence, which is some of the processes that we consider to be intelligent can be synthesized and can be replicated by a computer. But the thing that is intelligence is just simply not understood in order to be replicated in the first place. And it would be my suggestion here that even should it be understood, that the structures on which something we know as intelligence is actually created upon are going to be so complex that the computer that will replicate them is so far off in the future that any suggestion of AI within the next 15, 20, even 100 years is probably extremely unrealistic. And I would actually suggest that we're almost reaching some fundamental limits of the amount of data throughput that any piece of equipment can sustain and get rid of the heat that that data throughput generates. And this has always been the problem with computing, especially with the big server farms, is the amount of energy that they need and the amount of heat that they need to dissipate. And this is simply a byproduct, an inescapable byproduct of the frequency of the processor. So essentially, because the processor runs, in most cases, in your domestic computer, it's around 3 gigahertz. 3 gigahertz is the same frequency as your microwave oven. So there you get the analogy. So if you have 100 watt consumption processor and you run it at 100%, it basically produces 100 watts of heat like a light bulb. So basically the whole nano revolution, the nanotechnology, the robots and all this sort of, it's pipe dream stuff, people. It's really extremely unlikely to happen in the way that the technologists and the scientists would have you believe. And I say this as somebody who has really gone to the core of the subject and come up empty-handed in that respect, especially where the nano machines are concerned. They can't even get a cog to turn. It was lauded throughout the press that the scientists had made a cog out of, I think it was 9 atoms of something. And this was like a fabulous revolution in the days. Yeah, they'd made the cog, but they hadn't put it on a spindle and they hadn't tried to get it to move yet. When they did put it onto something akin to a spindle and attach it to another cog on something akin to a spindle, something called atomic stiction played a part and seized the entire device solid. So this is the absolute fundamental limit of nanotechnology. They cannot build it that small. It doesn't work. You know, physics doesn't work on that level in the way that the mainstream sciences understand it at all. The electric strong force comes into play and they've got no hope of getting these things to work. Simple as. Okay, so the other subject that this Bristol University lecturer covered in his seminar was the subject of digital natives, digital immigrants and analogues. Now, in the sort of internet community, these terminologies have come to take on a slightly different tone, and to some degree it's seen as a division, to divide the population up into those three arbitrary groups. However, I do speak entirely as on behalf of the analogues, and as an analogue, I grew up and got to the age of 16 or thereabouts, having known about computers, known about computer science on the most peripheral of an understanding. These were things that largely lived in research institutes. They filled entire buildings, and only the very academic elites and the military got access to them. Then, slowly through the computer revolution, we finally are presented with the desktop PC in the form of things like the BBC Micro and the Sinclair devices. And like I said, largely I was too poor to take part in any of that. And to be quite honest, they didn't seem that great at the time. All of my friends were wild about them, certainly my friends that had enough money to be able to buy these things to experiment with them. But I remember a friend of mine being so proud of himself when his computer printed out a picture of a bunny in ones and noughts on a page of paper. And this had been like the culmination of a week's work to achieve this task. And I really didn't see the great appeal in what they were doing and how they were doing it. So largely computers passed me by and I remained firmly within the world of the analogue, and certainly when the digital music revolution came around, I was the abject of Luddites, and to this day still refuse to buy compact discs as a form of storing music. I think it's a completely inadequate format. I'm still entirely vinyl based here. So really I'm coming from the perspective of having been an analogue, and having been an analogue and arriving in 1996 and being presented with this computer, this apex of technology of its day, even though it was entirely obsolete by the time I got my hands on it, I suddenly found myself a digital immigrant. I found myself in a land where I didn't speak the language, or if I did speak the language, I certainly spoke it with a very distinct accent. And it was very difficult to make myself understood amongst the digital natives. And effectively, the digital natives are those children who came of age in the digital age and who have never known anything but the digital age. And just to make that point, I've got a lovely little pod here by Stephen Fry, who's incredibly eloquent on the subject. And so I'll let him speak for me. Stephen Fry.
There are now people in their mid to getting on to advanced teens who have never known, obviously, a world without the web. In fact, there may be 20-year-olds who've never known anything about that. Have they developed strange thumbs? Do they have peculiar ways of talking and listening? Do their eyes glaze over when they have to concentrate for more than 30 seconds? No, I don't believe any of that. I'm not particularly negative or pessimistic about the social qualities, the linguistic qualities, the concentration qualities of Generation Web, as they're called. I honestly believe that if you were to go back into the 1920s and take an ordinary semi-educated 15-year-old and place him next to an ordinary semi-educated 15-year-old now, you would find the one now knows more, understands more, is more socially confident, is more aware of the rest of the world, is more able and more adept at research, may not be able to say their nine times table as fluently or repeat a moa massa matam amas amatis amant. They may not be able to do that. Is that such a great loss to an old-fashioned person like me? I'd love to think people could do both. But let's get real about this. Connection is what humans crave. It's what we are all about. It's something that separates us from animals. It's even comes before the fact that we have language, because the language is an example of a neural technology we have created to answer this need for connection. We are the social animal par excellence, or by devilry, if not necessarily excellence. We are constantly in need of connecting with people for friendship, love, sex, knowledge, growth, enmity, territoriality, all the imperatives that drive us as human beings. And we've created villages and towns to help us do that, and roads, and now we've created something else that allows us to do it even more. The human social history has been filled with inventions and developments and techniques that have threatened the way we arranged ourselves. A very good example that seems so peculiar is that Anthony Trollope, the English novelist, best known for writing books on politics and the church, was also a civil servant of some importance, and he invented the postbox, the pillar box. And he was distraught that his invention might undermine the Victorian family. Now, at first, it seems like, why would it do that? Well, until the time the pillar box arrived, the post box, the little red thing we put a letter in, a woman had never been able to write a letter and get it delivered without giving it either to a postman or to her father to be sent. The middle-class woman had no ability to connect with a man except through the graces of her parents, particularly her father. And Trollope, who was, although he was a fine novelist and an innovative thinker, was very traditionalist, and he hated the idea that there were women communicating with men without their father knowing about it, because they could just slip a letter into a postbox. And similarly, if you go back a little further to the time of Jane Austen, people found the idea of the novel simply horrific. People could not bear the idea of children sitting around reading. They should be... If they were going to read, it should be sermons and history, but certainly not novels. And they should be going about the place, sitting up straight and at dinner parties and you know, walking and being healthy. And then, of course, along came radio, and people couldn't bear the idea of people sitting around the radio, and then television, and then games, and then computers, and all these things seemed to those who were not brought up in them somehow to diminish, because we're all so proud of our youth. We think our youth and our childhood was somehow, if not perfect, it was, even if it was imperfect, it made us suffer. How dare these children now not suffer the way I did? They should be having the kind of life I did, made to read, made to do this. They should not have this freedom, this access. Or if they do, while I can approve of it, I ought to suggest that it's dangerous, that it's going to go wrong. Well, yeah, I mean, some genies, when they're let out of a bottle, can, you know, can cause problems, and they certainly can't ever go back in the bottle. When cars first arose, people were horrified at the deaths on the road. Horrified. They couldn't believe it. I mean, there were hundreds of people being squelched every day. It was grotesque. And you know, if you just braked in a car at 30 miles an hour, you'd kill yourself on the steering wheel, you'd break your neck. People were dying all the time. Did they say, oh, that's it then? We can't have cars. Sorry. In the same way as if someone says, actually, these mobile phones do give out microwaves, and they will give you brain cancer, are we going to say, oh, well, that's the end of that technology then? Not on your Nelly. There's a risk-reward ratio here. And for us, the reward is so great that whatever the risk is, we try and contain it and understand it at best. But what we don't do is say the risk is too great.
Okay, we just had a question in the chat from Babs there about the Linux operating system, basically asking, is this the same Linux that the top 10 organisations sponsoring the kernel development since the last report for kernel, Linux kernel, Red Hat, Intel, Nouvel, etc., 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 in Broadcom, you know what I mean, loads of fairly dark corporate entities there, apparently, taking an awful lot of their money and throwing it at Linux. As Nick so very succinctly put it in the chat box as well in reply, is that corporations fund Linux because they have to. Essentially, like I said earlier, Linux is the internet. Without Linux development, your internet portal will no longer work. So all of those companies will have huge internet presences, and all of that internet presence is likely to be built upon the foundation of the Linux kernel. Now, let's look into the development of the Linux kernel. The Linux kernel is a pyramidic structure. The initial code is effectively written by anybody that wants to. So you can go look at the code if you want, and if you don't like what you see there, you can rewrite it. And you can then present that code into the tier system, the tier structure of testing. And what this ensures is A, independence, and B, systems harmonizing. So as the software progresses through each tier of the structure, it is tested for its universality, in other words, that it will run on any piece of hardware, for its integrity, in as much as it is what it says it is and not anything else, and for its adherence to the GNU, which is the licensing regulating contract, which all open source software has to adhere to. What this basically means is that in writing your software, you do not claim it for yourself. You can monetize it through the systems the likes of Red Hat, but even Red Hat, in being forced to adhere to the GNU license system, may have an enormous towering empire of a corporation now based on the supplying and the maintenance of the Linux operating system for anything but free. It's extremely expensive to buy a Red Hat system. However, because of the terms of the GNU license, all of the very best code from the Red Hat systems all go into something called CentOS operating system. And CentOS is freely available to you or I, and is essentially the single best open source operating system for a mainframe computer, a server, or pretty much any sort of networked device that you want to be secure and hard as a nut. And essentially, because of this pyramidical structure, it actually doesn't matter how much time and money the corporations try to ply at bending Linux to their will and their desire. The code bunnies will outwrite them by at least 10 to 1. The lines of code being written daily for Linux outranks the entire code ever written for Microsoft and Mac pretty much every day. So the amount of code being written for the Unix system and for all of the kernels and the overlay of software that run on those systems is just an unfathomable pyramid. Which has independence literally built into its structures. Linus Torvald, the primary developer of the Linux system, from which it derives its name, just ensured that. Just go look into go look at Linus. Go look at Linus Torvald, and then come back to me and suggest for one moment that Linux is anything other than an entirely beneficent piece of software, though other people may be trying to do what they will with it. The core of Linux and the institute that has now become Linux is very much like the Google system that I was trying to present earlier, that the effort to maintain neutrality and to maintain openness and to maintain an authenticity to the principles that the web was founded on are very much built into the very structures of those particular those particular organisations. Okay, so let's go into exactly how the internet arrived. Essentially, Tim Berners-Lee created the software that allowed the internet to happen, that allowed the computers to talk to each other, that allowed things like Google to be created. And he did so in almost secret, and the actual kind of story goes that the internet as we have it today, the HTML and the IP addressing, was released into the wild for nearly 5 years before the military, who had paid for all of its development, found out what Tim had done, and by then it was too late to slam the back door on it. Essentially, Tim allowed the internet to go wild. What he was working in was something called DARPANET, which was the Military of Defense network, which was their very small number of mainframes. I think it was either 4 or 5 in total, that were hardwired together. These didn't use telephone wires. These actually had physical cables that connected them together. And the data that travelled down those physical cables was only actually readable by the computers at the end of them anyway, because they were the only equipment that worked in that particular code. So as a consequence, in as far as securing DARPANET, it was a matter of hardening the structures around them. The firewall around DARPANET was quite literally the buildings that contained the mainframes, and the level of security that any staff had to go through to enter or leave those sort of premises. And it was entirely under the military's control. But the trouble is, after Sputnik went up and the American military panicked because the Russians appeared to have developed intercontinental capabilities before they had, they suddenly discovered that the military didn't have all of the information that they needed or that they could get their hands on, and decided that DARPANET should become ARPANET. Well, ARPANET was a system utilising the telephone exchange system to exchange data between the very few university-based mainframes and the DARPANET. So essentially the DARPANET became this octopus that sprawled out across the university campuses and infested all of the various university mainframes. But because this DARPANET-ARPANET interface was running on Tim's software, and Tim hadn't put any passwords or any encryption into his software, so when the students started getting their own computers at home and modems and found that they could dial in to the mainframe at their local university and through their mainframe at the local university into all of the files that were publicly available over the ARPANET from DARPANET, that they were able to directly access the military's equipment. And like I say, this was a situation that actually went on for quite a number of years, and it wasn't until this became public knowledge that the door was suddenly slammed on the Pentagon's hardware, and we started to see, you know what I mean, some of the internet controls beginning to come in. Anyway, you really have to hear Tim tell the story for himself. So here's the man himself. Here's Tim Berners-Lee on how the internet was an accident.
Surfing the internet has become a commonplace activity, whether it's information, games...
Again, terribly sorry, this is the right piece of audio, but I've got the wrong piece of audio in my head. This is actually taken from an old BBC programme. This isn't Tim himself, this is a BBC programme about Tim's work. And it did the usual BBC fabulous slash job of giving you all the information and then in between telling you why you should be really, really afraid of it. So essentially I've gone through and I've slashed out all the bits of why you should be really, really afraid of it, and so this now plays as a piece on the history and the real history of the internet. And here goes, take two.
Surfing the internet has become a commonplace activity, whether it's information, games or bank transactions we're talking about. Billions of data are sent, received or processed round the clock. And today this global network is so easy to use. The technology behind it is called the World Wide Web, Along with email, it's the most frequently used internet application. Amazingly, we owe this revolutionary technology first and foremost to one brilliant programmer, Sir Timothy Berners-Lee. Timothy Berners-Lee was born in London on June 8, 1955. His parents were members of the team at Manchester University, which developed the Mark I, one of the first stored program computers. "When I came home from school one day," Berners-Lee remembers, "my father was reading a book on brain research. He was looking for clues as to how a computer might be taught to establish links in the same way that the human brain does. That's because the brain links things that have a common feature, even if at first they appear totally unrelated. When texts are linked together, we talk of hypertext." After the brief discussion with his father, Berners-Lee says he got on with his homework, but the idea of teaching a computer hypertext continued to preoccupy him. In 1973, Berners-Lee went to study physics at Oxford. As a student, he built his first computer using a soldering iron, transistors, an early microprocessor, and an old television set. After graduating, Berners-Lee worked as a programmer. In 1980, he spent 6 months in Switzerland as an independent contractor. With CERN, the European Centre for Particle Physics. At first, he had no idea who was responsible for what at CERN and which computer programs they were using. To gain an overview, he wrote his own program. It compared documents on staff members, their projects, and the software they were using. The program checked whether the documents contained certain key words. If so, their locations in the documents were interlinked. Remembering an old-fashioned encyclopedia from his childhood, Berners-Lee called his program Enquire. It was an apt name because, with its cross-references, the program functioned like an encyclopedia. Many entries ended with the recommendation "see also." Enquire's links led to a list of other documents with the same keywords. Since the program's links were based on the hypertext principle, Berners-Lee called them hyperlinks. His program only ran on the computer at CERN and was never published. Nevertheless, it formed the basis for the World Wide Web, which he developed later, because Berners-Lee didn't just want to interlink documents on one computer, he also wanted to interlink documents on several computers at different locations. It was this concept that resulted in the creation of the World Wide Web. An appropriate network of interconnected computers already existed in the form of the Internet. It was the ideal vehicle for the realization of Berners-Lee's vision. The origins of the Internet go back to the late 1950s, when America was stunned by a Russian breakthrough in the space race. In 1957, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik 1 to become the first nation to put a satellite in orbit around the Earth. The United States government felt compelled to act. It decided that every scrap of technological knowledge had to be collated and, above all, made available to the military at all times to avoid any further political embarrassment. In 1958, at the behest of President Eisenhower, Defense Minister Neil H. McElroy established the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA for short. Its brief, to focus on the new communication technologies. With Paul Barron at the helm, ARPA was commissioned to develop a computer network that would still function if parts of it failed. Barron soon realized that this could only be achieved with a decentralized structure, because with a centralized structure, there is only a path from A to B. If the central node fails to function, the information cannot reach its destination. A decentralized structure, however, enables the information to be diverted via point C if the central node is down. Thus, the Internet concept was born. In 1969, four computers at the universities of Stanford, Utah, Los Angeles, and Santa Barbara were interconnected via special telephone lines to form the first computer network, the ARPANET, the forerunner of today's Internet. The scientists who had access to this network quickly realized its value. Data could now be recalled at any time from computers far away. By 1974, the ARPANET had grown to encompass over 100 computers, some of them even outside the United States. The word Internet was coined. In 1983, it became the official term for the system. The problem with the ARPANET, however, was that it was used by very different types of computer.
Someone working with one particular system needed substantial computer knowledge to recall data from another system. Since the computers had different operating systems, they could not understand one another, just like two people speaking different languages. Tim Berners-Lee wanted to devise a common computer language so that every user of the network would be able to recall all available data, irrespective of the system they were stored in. In 1984, Berners-Lee returned to CERN, this time to take up a permanent post. His task was to create a documentation system that would enable CERN staff from all over the world to exchange and administer the results of their research more easily. To this end, amongst other things, Berners-Lee developed the two main building blocks of the World Wide Web. He called them HTML and URL. HTML is short for Hypertext Markup Language, while URL stands for Universal Resource Locator. HTML is a language all computers can understand. It creates text documents and makes hyperlinks. In other words, cross-reference is possible. A program known as a browser ensures the correct portrayal of an HTML document on the computer. As the name suggests, the second function of the browser is to browse or comb the net to locate and recall the information required. For this to be possible, every document needs a specific address under which it can be found. The URL, the Universal Resource Locator, developed by Berners-Lee. A URL starts with the letters www for World Wide Web. Then comes the name of the computer on which the data requested are stored. This is normally referred to as the server. The URL then ends with the actual name of the information sought. In our example, Berners-Lee as a subpoint of the chapter People. With this type of addressing, every document on every computer linked up to the internet is clearly designated. Right from the start, Berners-Lee had thought about a circle of users outside CERN. Consequently, he named his new product the World Wide Web. His computer at CERN became the web's first server. It provided access to all information on the World Wide Web. With this publication, Berners-Lee triggered off a chain reaction. The internet community, which already existed, had been waiting for an instrument like the World Wide Web. All over the world, its members now sat at their computers for days and nights, installing new servers, improving Berners-Lee's programming, and helping the WWW overcome its teething problems. One major difference from today was the user surface, as it's known, what the user sees on the monitor. At first, it was only possible to recall text, and all functions and commands had to be entered. So, in its infancy, the World Wide Web was still an instrument solely for experts. Then, in 1993, a student called Mark Andreessen programmed the Mosaic browser. For the first time, it integrated pictures and hyperlinks that could be activated simply with a mouse click. A year later, the browser was marketed under the name Navigator. Its screen-oriented concept revolutionized the World Wide Web. At the end of 1994, CERN officially bowed out of the development of the World Wide Web without having applied for any patents. The Institute still thought in terms of an open, non-commercial network. But software firms worldwide pounced on the net. Indeed, 1994 is seen as the year in which the World Wide Web became big business. Tim Berners-Lee took no share in the boom. Instead of embarking on risky business adventures, he preferred to focus on the further development of the web. The World Wide Web has come a long way since its modest beginnings in the early 1980s. Since 1994, the number of participants has grown by leaps and bounds. By 2002, there were already 2.5 billion web pages, and the number continues to increase. Without the World Wide Web, just-in-time production, which shifts the stocks of entire warehouses to trucks on the road, would be just as inconceivable as globalization, with all its negative consequences. Just 4 years after it was launched, the Wikipedia encyclopedia alone contained over 290,000 entries. Constantly updated, they also offered diverse links to all possible topics from A to Z. And to bid successfully at an online auction, you also need access to the communication platform of the 21st century. In recent years, its inventor, Tim Berners-Lee, has received numerous awards. In June 2004, he was knighted by Queen Elizabeth II. He keeps a critical eye on the development of the World Wide Web. Asked whether the web had made mankind more intelligent, Berners-Lee said, "Not really, but we're linked better."
Uh, Okay, so I hope you got from that that, like I say, this was an almost accidental release into the wild for software that had been developed primarily for the military and for the CERN establishment. But because of the establishment of those two institutions being so behind the curve when it came to the code bunnies like Berners-Lee, that effectively they didn't know to slam the stable door until well and truly after the horse had bolted. And so it's not until after these sort of times, the 1994s, that we begin to see the first sort of rumblings of internet controls being bandied around. And certainly, I mean, the military slammed the door on all of their institutes and began to invent things like firewalls and stuff that are commonplace today. In those days, a firewall was an actual piece of hardware that just made sure that nobody got in or out of the network without encryption. So we're sort of ranging into the sort of realm of net neutrality and of the net control. And like I say, this thing appears to have been released into the wild, and certainly from its complete failure to be promoted by any of the mainstream media, and all of the sort of press being nothing but fear-mongering about the entire situation. I think that Stephen Fry was very eloquent when he was speaking there about how this has happened with every revolution in information technology whenever it's happened in the past, right from the invention of the post box and the postal services, from common literature like romance novels. So, on the topic of internet controls, there were some being put through Congress in 1996, and while this piece refers to them actually having passed through Congress and being instated, I think this is actually slightly premature, and that those bills actually fell at the first hurdle. I'm not sure entirely about the history, but I seem to recall from the sort of undercurrents of the time that the rumour on the internet, certainly of its day, was that what actually happened was that the congressmen who were supposed to be voting in Congress that day against the internet and for the internet control bill that was being presented at that time had woken up that morning and opened their email accounts or their personal computers, and found on every single desktop a personal message from the white hat hackers addressed to them personally, and including a folder of all of their known miscreances and nefarious dealings that were circulating throughout the internet. And so apparently that bill fell at that first hurdle. So here's me reading the Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace by John Perry Barlow. This was initially presented as a piece to camera, which actually made it to the news medias of its day. I think the news medias were so hungry for anything internet related that a name as big as John Perry Barlow, who is one of the front men of the Grateful Dead in the 60s and who converted to the cyberpunk movement in the 70s and was one of the founding members of the cyberpunk movement, way before there were even domestic PCs, so he was one of the sort of imagineers of the internet age. Anyway, this is an incredibly powerful piece that he gave to camera, and I dearly wish that he hadn't done the re-renditions of it, having had that piece of incredible footage been lost to posterity, which appears to be the case now. So unfortunately, there's no actual record of him standing there as this dreadlock-infested cyberpunk hench, sort of 20-plus stone scary self of its day, shaking his finger at the camera. And all of his retellings of it these days appear to be rather lacklustre. And so I had already recorded this. If any of you are familiar with my old YouTube channel, you'll find a rendition of this from way back when I sort of first stumbled across the failure of the internet to having captured the original telling, and complete failure of anybody to upload it. I recorded a rendition of this a long time back. I was incredibly hack-throated. I was very tired, and it's a bit of a lackluster telling, and I was a little disappointed. However, on replaying it to a friend recently, it still put the hackles up on my neck, regardless of the slightly disappointing technical nature of that particular recording. So I re-recorded this recently, so hopefully this is the Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace by John Perry Barlow, read with gusto by my good self. A Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace by John Perry Barlow. Governments of the industrial world, you weary giants of flesh and steel, I come to you from cyberspace, the new home of mind. On behalf of the future, I ask you of the past to leave us alone. You are not welcome among us. You have no sovereignty where we gather. We have no elected government, nor are we likely to have one. So I address you with no greater authority than that which liberty itself always speaks. I declare the global social space we are building to be naturally independent of the tyrannies you seek to impose on us. You have no moral right to rule us, nor do you possess any methods of enforcement we have true reason to fear. Governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed. You have neither solicited nor received ours. We did not invite you. You do not know us, nor do you know our world. Cyberspace does not lie within your borders. Do not think you can build it, though it were a public construction project. You cannot. It is an act of nature, and it grows itself through our collective actions. You have not engaged in our great and gathering conversation, nor did you create the wealth of our marketplaces. You do not know our culture, our ethics, or the unwritten codes that already provide our society more order than could be obtained by any of your impositions. You claim that there are problems among us that you need to solve. You use this claim as an excuse to invade our precincts. Many of these problems don't exist. Where there are real conflicts, where there are wrongs, we will identify them and address them by our means. We are forming our own social contract. This governance will arise according to the conditions of our world, not yours. Our world is different. Cyberspace consists of transactions, relationships, and thought itself arrayed like a standing wave in the web of our communications. Ours is a world that is both everywhere and nowhere, but is not where bodies live. We are creating a world that all may enter without privilege or prejudice accorded by race, economic power, military force, or station of birth. We are creating a world where anyone, anywhere, may express his or her beliefs, no matter how singular, without fear of being coerced into silence or conformity. Your legal concepts of property, expression, identity, movement, and context do not apply to us. They are all based on matter, and there is no matter here. Our identities have no bodies, so unlike you, we cannot obtain order by physical coercion. We believe that from ethics, enlightened self-interest, and the commonwealth, our governance will emerge. Our identities may be distributed across many of your jurisdictions. The only law that all our constituent cultures would generally recognize is the golden rule of do no harm. We hope we will be able to build our particular solutions on that basis, but we cannot accept the solutions you are attempting to impose. In the United States today, you have created a law, the Telecommunications Reform Act, which repudiates your own constitution and insults the dreams of Jefferson, Washington, Mill, Madison, de Tocqueville, and Brandreis. These dreams must now be born anew in us. You are terrified of your own children, since they are natives in a world where you will always be immigrants. Because you fear them, you entrust your bureaucracies with the parental responsibilities you are too cowardly to confront yourselves. In our world, all of the sentiments and expressions of humanity, from the debasing to the angelic, are parts of a seamless whole, the global conversation of bits. We cannot separate the air that chokes from the air upon which wings beat. In China, Germany, France, Russia, Singapore, Italy, and the United States, you are trying to ward off the virus of liberty by erecting guard posts at the frontiers of cyberspace. These may keep out the contagion for a short time, but they will not work in a world that will soon be blanketed in bit-bearing media. Your increasingly obsolete information industries would perpetrate themselves by proposing laws in America and elsewhere that claim to own speech itself throughout the world. These laws would declare ideas to be another industrial product, no more noble than a pig iron. In our world, whatever the human mind may create can be reproduced and distributed infinitely at no cost. The global conveyance of thought no longer requires your factories to accomplish. These increasingly hostile and colonial measures place us in the same position as those previous lovers of freedom and self-determination who had to reject the authorities of distant, uninformed powers. We must declare our virtual selves immune to your sovereignty. Even as we continue to consent to your rule over our bodies, we will spread ourselves across the planet so that no one can arrest our thoughts. We will create a civilization of the mind in cyberspace. May it be more humane and fair than the world your governments have made before. John Perry Barlow, Davos, Switzerland, February the 8th, 1996. So we've just done Declaration of Cyberspace by Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace by John Perry Barlow. I'm going to duck the next Tim Berners-Lee because I'm aware we're now into the last half hour and I really need to round this up and really cover the core subject of tonight, which is the Googleplex. And more specifically, the deep Googleplex. Let's really go into the structures that we're talking about here. I already alluded earlier in the program to the Googleplex being a kind of global mind and being effectively an organic structure. And Tim has alluded to its exponential nature in some of the numbers that he was coming out with there, the 10 times multiplication in things like users and number of pages being uploaded, the amount of code being written in every year is almost 10 times exponential of the previous year. So it's not just 10 times, it's 10 times 10, it's 100 times more data than was being produced the previous year. Whether that's still true to this day, I'm not too sure. But anything that adheres to an exponential is effectively a fractal of a sort. So we can view the soft side of the Googleplex, the data that's travelling through it and the code that's being written to transmit and collect and collate that data. All appears to be on this incredible exponential fractalized path. So what we're seeing is the hardware of the Googleplex has become the structures of the global mind of the Googleplex. And as I alluded to earlier, we have effectively become the soft nodes, the organic nodes on the ends of those networked terminals, those computer-based terminals. And each of those computer-based terminals, as Tim Wernerly so eloquently described, were an organic structure that came from, were initially derived from the way that humans think. And the reason why they have become so ubiquitous is because they perfectly match the way that humans like to communicate. We like words. We like the interplay of words. We like the accessibility to all the words that we'd like to read. And moreover, we prefer those words to be being written by a live individual or spoken by a live individual at the other end of the wire and the hardware that's connecting the two of you together. Much like now. And so if we consider ourselves, us at the terminal, the operators, in effect, of this global mind, the drivers of this global mind. Because like I say, this global mind is purely arithmetic. It's purely algebraic. It has no actual thoughts of its own. So we can consider the thoughts of this global mind to be being generated by us, the synapses. Yeah? And that those thoughts are our thoughts. And its mind is our mind, but it's a collective mind. It's a mind that we all feed into and feed from, whether we're aware of that position or not. And again, I would suggest that because this mind analogy, if we extend that to the concept of the synapse, the thing that does the calculating is carried out upon within the human brain, that the average kind of human synapse may have a single input node and maybe 5 or 7 output nodes leading to other synapses. Well, if we consider this in terms of networking, then as far as you at your terminal, you become that synapse. Only your inputs and outputs aren't 5 or 7. You've got 5 or 7 senses alone. And each of those senses are beyond the capability that any machine could ever dream of having. And then to add to that, you have a conscious mind with which to experience those senses, to order the information from those senses into things that appear to be relevant to you. And you post those things on the internet. You tell them to Facebook, you send emails to your friends. And all of that that appears on the white web, all of the stuff that appears in the unpasworded pages that a Google search engine can find and distribute, is all effectively voluntary participation. Nobody forced you to write those words. There's nobody standing there holding a gun to your head, asking you to write them or demanding that you write them. Nobody's paying you to do it. So probably 99% of everything that the internet isn't coming from a corporation. It's not coming from some monetized institution. Yeah, it's coming from somebody wishing to express that emotion, that experience, that understanding, that knowledge, that intention to somebody else. And the internet is the most incredible structure for allowing one person to talk directly to hundreds of others. I mean, if I was to add up all of my various subscribers and kind of followers over Skype, the people that occupy the Open Omniversity room on Skype and the applied bioenergetics room on Skype and all of my followers on my main YouTube channel and all of my followers on the Omniversity channel, then we're probably talking about 1,000 people that I'm able to speak to directly. That is inconceivable to me, that 1,000 people are able to hear my voice and reasonably go and find my spoken word pieces and refer to them, let alone share them and refer back to them. So the Googleplex isn't something that Google created for us. It's something that we created for Google. It's all that Google did was allow the maths that the Google engine is derived from to be available to the public. And in as much as such, as regardless of their sort of corporate need to maintain secrecy over the bit that they use at their end, which is how they make their money after all. Without making their money, they can't exist. So we have to allow them the liberty to put food on their table, as it were. And again, I would suggest that the reason why Google ducks so much tax is because it applies nearly everything that it earns profit-wise back into building a bigger Googleplex, a better Googleplex. And this is how it ducks out the majority of sort of corporate tax, regardless of its immense size. So really, I want to encourage everybody that uses Google, everybody that uses an internet terminal on anything, be that from your smart enabled television set to your mobile phone to your tablet to your laptop to your desktop PC to your work PC to a computer mainframe, I want you to realize that you're a node on this global mind, and that the very fabric that global mind is created upon is your input and your output. So don't just click on any bloody link that you see on Facebook just because you're bored. Because by clicking on that link, you're giving that page a page priority in a page rank in a Google search. So what you're doing is you're ensuring that absolute nonsense is distributed to even more people. And this is one of the fundamental concepts behind the Open University when I first had it, was to try and find a way of making a portal within the YouTube interface that filtered most of the rubbish that's on YouTube and tried to present vetted, respectable works that could be universally held to have truth and authenticity and legitimacy. And at the same time, while I was doing that, what I actually found, to my great delight, was that the majority of pieces that on the internet that conform to that are also A, hugely entertaining, B, hugely informative, and C, usually incredibly inspiring, that the speakers who are the best educators and the best talkers on their subject generally tend to be quite an entertainment to watch and listen to. And so it would be very easy to go and enter the pages of the Open Omniversity YouTube playlist page and spend weeks in there being absolutely entertained, finding nothing there that particularly disconnects with anything that you thought that you might know, but simply builds upon the foundations of what you may already know and augments those, and basically educates you by the back door. So in being entertained, you become educated. So essentially what I'm trying to encourage everybody not to be is an ignorant terminal, to be an ignorant synapse. Effectively, the sharing of pretty kitten photos may be all very good and may brighten people's day, and I certainly wouldn't tell people not to do such a thing. But essentially what you're doing is you're making the Googleplex's global mind stupid. And that's in your hands entirely. This is the most democratic thing ever to have happened in humanity. And so it's not under some governmental control, although they would dearly like it to be. I don't think it's under a great deal of corporate control, again, although they would dearly like it to be. Be very cautious of any offers of an upgrade to the internet. I must try and encourage people not to use ad blocker if they can desperately avoid it, or at least use it intelligently. Again, don't be unintentional about your use of the internet. Don't be ignorant about your use of the internet. Essentially, a large number of the websites that you probably refer to for your independent sources of information will be solely funded from their ad revenue from the Google ads that they carry down the side of their page. Now, you probably will have noticed that on an actual Google search page, there aren't actually any pictorial adverts or video adverts being presented. The advertising on the Google search engine is very much done, publicly. So when something is advertised content, when the page rank is there, not because of the equity and applicability of that as a search term, but it's there at the top of your browser page because somebody paid for it to be there. Well, Google puts it there, which you might see as a bad thing, but it puts underneath advertisement, and it puts the cheaper ones down the side, and it puts next to them advertisement. And that pretty much is the Google model. Now, apart from that, these Google ads that you see in the web pages that you go to that appear to have some sort of third sense about your shopping habits and seem to modify them according to what you last went onto the internet to buy, well, that's exactly how the Google model works. It's able to sell advertising at incredibly high cost rates, because unlike any other advertising medium ever in the history of humanity, it can absolutely guarantee precisely how much traffic you're going to get from your advertising revenue, precisely how much additional traffic that's going to bring you, how long that traffic's going to stay on your site, and whether that traffic is likely to buy anything on your site. Because as the man said in What is the Google Search Algorithm, it's precisely that. It presents you with exactly what you want the most. And so it takes every single search that you've ever put through Google, and it compares that to your current search. It compares that to all of the pages that you have clicked upon with the search terms that it's presented you with in the past. It determines how many times you'll go past the first page and into the sort of deeper Googleplex. And so, the way that we use the internet is vitally important to the actual structure of the very internet itself. And so, like I say, turn off your ad blockers if you can. Personally, I do keep my ad blocker on. I could be just simply justifying that to my own satisfaction, but I tend to think that I pay for my internet service and I pay for certain other pay-for internet services. The majority of the sites that I use are voluntarily paid for by the site producer, and willingly so. So the majority of sites that I go to that do carry advertising, it's simply to fund a corporate pocket, and so my ad blocker is generally on. And as such a prolific producer of material to the internet and on the internet, I publish thousands of words to the internet each month, coordinate and collate those words, often spoken in various chat mediums, down into condensed documents, which I then publish to the public domain through my Google Documents folder. And I often distribute these over the internet so that people can share them. So as a consequence, I personally feel that my part as a synapse on the Googleplex's global mind is one of equity, and that I more or less supply as much to the global mind as I receive from it. And so the very nature that all of my work is done fully unmonetized, I expect no remuneration or reward for anything that I do on the internet. I do it purely for the benefit of my fellows, my peers, and those that come after us. I understand the nature of the structures that we all use as the internet, possibly more deeply than most. As Tim Berners-Lee says, the actual study of the internet as a structure is not something that is done. Even the best academics have no idea of the thing that they work within and upon. So really, yeah, I'm just trying to encourage everybody not to be fearful of what's coming with the internet. But if you see something that you don't like, don't necessarily act against it, because your click traffic that you'll generate by raising awareness of that thing may be the very thing that's feeding that thing into existence in the first place. So first of all, withdraw your click traffic from anything that you disapprove of or disagree of. This includes going to YouTube channel and watching videos about the conspiracy theories around it and the likes, because this still promotes this through the page ranking system. So effectively, become an intentional node on the internet. Become the conscious terminal on a global mind. And let's see if we can't elevate this rather stupid beast that we've created with all of our wish for greater and greater speed of communication and ability to communicate with each other. And let's start using it for what it was let out into the wild for. Let's start communicating with each other. Let's start educating each other. Let's start elevating our neighbours and our friends out of the ignorant mire that they Facebook and they Twitter with, and begin to educate our fellows and actually create the world that some of the internet pioneers and some of the code pioneers actually dreamed of for us and created for us. And so, you know what I mean? I often say, you know what I mean, the 20th century built the 21st century, but the 20th century is done. Let's inhabit the 21st century, and let's do it together, because that's the real great thing of the internet, is it's the great and global gathering of humanity, which has never happened before in the history of humanity. Any of you that are still with me and still hanging on to the grim death, You must be mad. What is wrong with you? Get some bloody sleep. It's coming up to 4 a.m. Anyway, this is me, slightly flippantly, Freeman Jack, signing off for the Open Omniversity. Here's some tunes.
Trust me. I fully appreciate the seriousness of my situation. But I promise you, I won't spend a single second.